Simon & Schuster Audio presents Stolen Beauty, a novel by Laurie Lico Albanese. Read by Madeleine Maby and Gabra Zackman, with Gibson Fraser.
The portrait of Adela Blockbauer I measures 54 inches by 54 inches unframed and weighs 22 pounds 8 ounces. She has 16 eyes, 15 grams of gold, and 7 grams of silver. Her dress is decorated with erotic signs and Egyptian symbols. The eyes of Horus to defend against evil, the three-sided ka that infuses the portrait with an indelible spirit. She's a queen and a seductress, a Jewess trapped in a lost world. Her lips are parted, as if she is about to say something that we will never hear.
Maria, 1938. I was a love-struck newlywed when Hitler came to Austria. Outside, the Ringstrasse was streaming with cars, trams, and pedestrians in belted trench coats. Inside, we were waltzing and drinking French champagne. My dear friend Lily had just become engaged to a Catholic man, and the glittering ballroom was in full swing. Music was playing. It was Schubert. And men in bow ties were circulating with trays of crab cakes and miniature mushroom torts. Someone toasted the happy couple. There was crystal and dresses the colors of hyacinths and tulips. The dance floor was a blur of pastels. It was a long time ago, but I can still see everything clearly. I was wearing violet perfume, and dusk was approaching. Fritz moved like a panther in his tuxedo as he crossed the room toward me. My mother was wearing a shimmering gray dress, and my father was holding his bow over the cello strings when someone shouted, "The Chancellor is making a speech." Aunt Adela was long in her grave, but I saw my Uncle Ferdinand put out a hand to steady himself near the cocktail bar.
"Schuschnigg is on the radio," the man shouted again in an angry voice. "Silence, everyone."
The violinists ripped their bows from the strings, and our host turned up the volume on the radio. The Chancellor's voice rang across the room just as Fritz reached my side. Every bit of my husband's childhood in the Jewish ghetto had been polished away by then, replaced by elegant manners, a starched white shirt, and a clear operatic baritone. He put his arm around my shoulder, and his ruby cufflink brushed my cheek, a cool spot in the warm room.
"Men and women of Austria, this day has placed before us a serious and decisive situation," Chancellor von Schuschnigg said.
He took a choked breath that we could hear through the radio waves. Men I'd known since I was a girl turned pale. They lowered their champagne flutes and balled up their cocktail napkins. Lily wilted against her father's thin frame. Someone tipped over a glass and it shattered. The Chancellor said that Hitler's army was at our borders, and for one more second I believed our small country was about to go to war. I thought we would fight the Germans, and that we could win.
"We have decided to order the troops to offer no resistance," the Chancellor said. "So I take leave of the Austrian people with a German word of farewell uttered from the depth of my heart. God protect Austria."
A strange sound came from my husband's throat. I saw my mother mouth my father's name, Gustav, and my father mouth hers, Teddy, in a single moment that seared itself into my mind like a photograph. A woman fainted, and sirens began to wail in the streets outside. I saw Uncle Ferdinand waving in my direction, but my parents circled around us, saying, "Secure your money. Secure your jewels. Go home.
Lock your doors. Get your passports. Get out. And then Fritz and I were pouring outside into the fading evening with everyone else. Church bells were ringing, and hundreds of people were crowding into the streets waving Nazi flags. I had no idea there were so many Austrians just waiting for the Führer. But there they were, hordes of ordinary Gentiles who thought Hitler was right and the Jews were to blame for their problems. Poverty, sadness, cold, whatever it was they were angry about, Hitler wanted them to blame us. And they did. They were smiling and laughing and waving their swastikas. They were shouting, "Germany is united. Long live Hitler." We all knew what had been happening to the Jews in Germany, but until that moment, it had seemed a world away. If that makes us willfully ignorant or foolish and naive, then that's what we were. There's no other way to say it. Behind the wheel of our new black sedan, Fritz stared straight ahead. Men in brown uniforms marched arm in arm through the street as if they'd stepped right from the thick walls of the Ringstrasse buildings. Soldiers stood like hard marionettes with their chins thrust into the air. I wanted to ask Fritz where they'd been hiding with their pressed uniforms and shining swastika pins, but when I saw tears on my husband's face, I bit the inside of my cheek and swallowed my words. By the time we reached the Altman Textiles factory grounds, where we lived in our newlywed apartment, Fritz had composed himself and looked as much like the vice president of the business as he could manage.
"Four men were here, asking for you," the gateman said.
Otto was a strong man with a clean, square jawline and two lovely children. He secured the padlock behind us, and for the first time in my life it occurred to me that I was locked inside the gates.
"They wanted to see the man who runs the factory."
"What did you tell them?" Fritz asked.
"I said Bernard Altman is away on business and Fritz Altman is here in Austria."
"What did they say?" Otto blanched.
"They said there is no Austria anymore."
Inside the apartment, we bolted the door, turned off the lights, and crawled under the blankets. We'd been married only 4 months. I was 22, and Fritz was 30. But we held each other like frightened children.
"You'll leave right away," Fritz whispered, "tomorrow, if it's possible. You go with Uncle Ferdinand, and I'll join you as soon as I can."
My Uncle Ferdinand and Fritz's brother, Bernard, had both tried to warn us about Hitler, but their fears had seemed hazy and improbable, and we'd listened the way most of Austria had listened, with one hand on the radio dial searching for music and entertainment.
"I'm not leaving without you," I said. "We'll wait until your passport is renewed."
I had a valid passport, but Fritz's had expired after our honeymoon. We'd filled out the paperwork, filed for a renewal, and forgotten about it. That had been a month ago.
"I'm not going to get a passport now," Fritz said.
Lights from the factory grounds shone through our bedroom window, illuminating his face in zigzagged shadows.
"The Nazis aren't going to give me one. You go first, and I'll come as soon as I can."
"Go where?" I asked. "I don't want to go anywhere without you."
"Go with your uncle to Jungfraubrunnen," he said. "That's where he said he would go if Hitler came. Czechoslovakia will be safe."
Only then did I remember my uncle waving to me on the dance floor.
"I'll call Uncle Ferdinand in the morning," I said. "He'll make sure we can get out together."
I pressed my cheek against Fritz's and recalled the faint cinnamon of his aftershave on the night we'd met. There had been music and men in tuxedos that night, too. A cool breeze coming through an open window at the lawyer's ball, and a line of women holding their dance cards and waiting for the second waltz.
"Just look at him,"
I'd breathed to Lily when Fritz walked by. He'd moved as I thought a lover might move when he wanted a woman, as if there was velvet under his feet. And there was the cinnamon scent, like warm bread and breakfast in bed, lingering in his wake.
That's Fritz Altman, Lily had whispered. He's an amateur opera singer and a real charmer. I admit he's a looker, but don't waste your time on him. He's crazy about a married woman.
I might have heeded my friend's warning if Fritz hadn't climbed onto the music stage just then and silenced the room with Schubert's aching love song. You are peace, the gentle peace. You are longing, and what stills it? Maybe he was a playboy, but his voice had the warmth of a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.